What's up everybody, George here from Perpetual Paradox, and you're watching Concert Junkies with Rob and John. Perpetual Paradox started with me feeling miserable about not playing guitar. And my girlfriend was like, can you please stop talking about your bands that you used to play and just buy a guitar and find friends, I don't know, meet some people, make a band. And that was literally it. I bought a guitar, I put a post on Facebook, and then I met up with a few guys, including Adrian, which is still in the band, the singer, because other members that we met, kind of like, we went through a roller coaster of swapping members at the beginning. There was just like no dedication, no passion, just no commitment, no sacrifice from certain people. And from the original kind of like first lineup, there's only me and Adrian, but we were never really a band until our first live gig, and at the first live gig was already with Oliver. So after Oliver joined, that's when things were like, yes, we're a band, let's do this. But the previous drummer that we had before Will, some stuff happened as well, and absolutely no bad blood really, but he had to leave, and then we found Will, and we've been like properly active since January 2022, because 2020 and 2021 was a bit like, yeah, COVID. It was hard, but we all just produced at home and we did like little demos and stuff. And I think we realized we wanted to do this as a band from January 2022, basically. And we've been doing nonstop. Right, first question. Can you walk us through the journey of creating your latest album, song? What was the inspiration behind it? The last EP, Condemnation, came out in April this year, April 4th. It's basically all the skills and all the everything we do as each member, basically, just, you know what, let's mix all the influences, let's push the boundaries of our capabilities. And that was Condemnation. The musicianship was like accepting the mixing of like genres between the five of us, and Condemnation came out. It could be considered as a concept EP, like the five tracks do connect to each other, and there's a reason why, like from the first track to the fifth track, there's a connection to it lyric wise and the names as well, and the artwork. And it's not a full on concept album, but it's connected because the message from track one to track five, it's this journey of how people feel with their lives and being rebellious towards like government, politics, religion, your parents, anything that it makes you like, I want to be myself, I want to do what I want to do, like I want to do what I'm passionate, whatever finds you that thing of feeling alive. And it's accepting the fact that we've gone down to the depth of darkness and hell, and you know, we got to get back up for whatever reason it is that we go through. So whatever struggles we had in life, the things we've, you know, witnessed, experienced, and the culmination of everything, and yeah, the journey of getting back up, really. Number two, how do you think your music has evolved since you first started as a band? It's changed. If you go to our whatever platform, music platform you use, and you listen to our songs and since EP number one to this last one, you can check the difference. I think swapping the members and pushing ourselves not to the limit, but like, you know, evolving, developing our skills, our capabilities, and see what can we do, and accepting like 100%, let's mix what we all love. It made that huge difference that if you listen to our first EP called Endless Cycle, and then you go to Monophobia, and then you go to condemnation, it's a huge difference. So it's a big, big difference. I don't dislike or regret or, you know, I've got no negative points about previous songs that we've made. Like, everything was amazing. It's just a journey. We just get better. We are happy to think that we're getting better, at least to ourselves. As much as we want to please the crowd, we want to please the listeners, but we want to please ourselves, and that is very important. So I think evolving comes from there. It's that, you know, the obstacle of like, can I be more complex? Can I be faster? Can I be more technical? And we all share that. We genuinely all share that. And I think that's what makes condemnation to be condemnation. But we just want to do more and better. So we've already been working on new songs. And you'll know what I mean when eventually it comes out. Question number three. What role does each band member play in the songwriting process? I think we're one of those bands where me or Oliver will make a riff and have some sort of theme going on with the riff. So we will have a rough idea of like the drums and everything. Me more than Oliver most of the time, along with the riff, I've got like something in my head that the riff means something to me, like the message or the lyrics or the theme, and I would send the riff to Adrian and I will name the riff. But I will name the riff according to something that I feel like, I don't know, if it's giving me some sort of, this is going to be a song about, I don't know, like about saving animals, then the title will be related to that. And I'll go back to Adrian and be like, oh, you know, in my head, this is what I'm thinking. And then most of the time, Adrian is happy to grab that name that I created for that riff and will write something around it. But 90% of the time, me and Oliver will make a riff. The riff becomes a song because we ended up making like intro and bridge and chorus and solos maybe, or breakdown, and we structure something in our heads, and then it goes to Will and Adrian. As much as Will is our drummer, well, Adrian has great musicianship skills, so it goes to both of them, and then they'll probably do the drums together and structure the song together and maybe, you know, throw their ideas. Andre as well, he'll probably say like, guys, maybe a breakdown after or whatever it is. But so far, we're really good at working with each other in this aspect of like creating music. And again, we have so many different influences between the five of us that it works really well. Question number four. Are there any specific themes or messages you try to convey through your music? Kind of. I know that Adrian has his love for like creepy, dark, hell, I don't know, like, not just about like monsters and nightmares, but like Adrian always tries to relate that with society, politics, government, just life in general, like just our lives, the real world, and this sort of like nightmare slash sci-fi darkness, whatever thing he's feeling about it or emotional about it. And he mixes it together and he makes it sound like it is some sort of demon, monster, you know, something that the lyric is talking about. But at the same time, that monster, that demon is probably like a president or a politician or your dad or, you know, and you can take it as you wish when you listen to the songs and you read the lyrics. But I think that's mainly it. Number five. How do you handle creative differences within the band when working on new music? We handle it really well. As I said, we have, like, the five of us have completely different strong influences. We share a lot of bands in common that we love, but there's a difference between, for example, me and Oliver, we love a certain band, but that doesn't mean that the exact same band influences us a lot. I love Lamb of God, Machine Head, and, you know, Metallica, and all those classic bands. Like, I love them, but they're probably not my main influence. My influence varies with what I'm passionate at the moment, and I take it as a something that I've never played before, or a different, I don't know, picking technique, or a scale I've never tried before, or a style of riff I've never tried before, and then I mix it with my own taste. I started to play guitar when I was 16, and at that point for me it was like Machine Head, Lamb of God, Slipknot, and everything was groovy. I love groovy riffs, I love breakdowns. I still love breakdowns, it's probably my favorite thing. So I will always have that groovy riffing thing. But along the years and until now, I would say that probably on my favorite top bands is Psilosis and Bleed From Within. And my riffing style became very Psilosis recently. And I love that. And every band member has its thing. Even if it's Will with Iron Maiden and his heavy metal and Santa Cruz. But at the same time, I know he loves his technical stuff. And Adrian, for example, loves Avenged Sevenfold, but he's also really deep into deathcore. So he mixes both a lot. If we make a chorus, the chorus will probably be like very clean, very poppy, very bright, but then a breakdown comes and is depth of hell. Number six, what do you hope listeners take away from your music? Honestly, anything and everything. I don't know, every person is different when they listen to something, because different people will relate differently to a riff, a breakdown, lyrics, a chorus, the message, the theme. You know, if I've been through something in life and I relate to the song, it'll probably be super emotional for me. But if I haven't been through anything emotional that relates to the song, I'll probably just be like, yeah, sick breakdown or amazing solo. So it depends. As long as it makes people happy, as long as it makes people feel the emotion of what we're writing, take it as you will. Number seven. Can you share a memorable moment or experience that has had a significant impact on your music? Personally, there's a lot of different moments, a lot of memorable, like, I've loved so many different situations, including this past Friday that we've opened for Crypta. For me, it was like a dream come true. Not the fact that we finally opened for like a famous band, but I've been listening to Crypta for like, I would say 2 years. Or more. But since they dropped that album with the song called The Other Side of Anger. sorry. And I was spinning that song back and forth. And funny enough, a couple of weeks ago, we got asked to open for Crypta. That for me was one of the best feelings ever. That's very memorable for me. But a specific moment that I was like, fuck yeah. Back in February this year, so months ago, we played at Signature Brew here in London, Black Horse Road. And in our last song, during the song, while I was playing, there was a mosh pit happening. And I love a good mosh pit. And I had to. I stopped playing. I put my guitar on the floor and I joined the mosh pit. That was... Number eight. How do you think the current music industry landscape has influenced your approach to creating and releasing music? Releasing, it's just like what everybody's doing nowadays. You know, it's the world you live in. It's digital platforms. It is what it is. I mean, there's not much to talk about it. We're in 2024, so it's extremely rare that someone asks for like a CD or a vinyl or a cassette tape, unless you're a big fan of someone and that someone is really famous and they do have the budget to make it limited editions of CDs and vinyls and cassette tapes, which apparently are back. But things have evolved a lot. I think metalheads and just like people who love music in general really need to accept technology to be part of the development of music, because it's easy to compose, it's easy to make music. Everybody can buy a laptop, an interface, a microphone, a guitar, and just compose at home and make a demo. But then it's up to what others are doing that you relate to, or the influences, or I don't know. Yeah, it's hard to talk about this because I feel like, unfortunately, if it's not for social media, nothing really works nowadays. So yeah, it's hard. It's hard. There's a lot of artists, there's a lot of bands that we all seek the same, but we all go after the ones that are making it. So we're like, oh, this is what you're doing. But then eventually everybody does it. So it's hard. It's very hard. It's very complicated. But we don't give up. We push forward and we do our best. Number 9. What advice would you give to aspiring musicians based on your experiences in the industry? Just don't give up. This is like the lame response that I can give you, the most lame response, because everybody says this, you know, it's the typical, don't give up and, you know, have faith and, you know, you never know, everything happens for a reason. But it's true. It's true. But at least if you don't give up on yourself, then you cannot deny that you've done it. You know, make sure that you have the best friends around you. You're surrounded by the best friends around you. But when I say best friends, it's not people that support your music. I'm talking about even like people that, apart from support, they're like, they become, it's just a level of friendship that they become family. Like, that's how I feel in my band. Adrian, Andre, Will, Oliver, I would literally die for those guys. Like, they're not just my bandmates. They're family. They're like, they're the best people I've ever met. They're all very different from each other, but they're the best people I've ever met. I would literally die for them. And I'm not going to say this because I know you're going to watch it and then you'll be like, oh, George said this. No, but it's true. You know, like, when you're surrounded by the best people, you're happier, you have more passion, and you power through. So especially in the band, if you're not a solo artist, especially in the band, make sure that your other band members are like you. They're funny, they're outgoing, they're supportive, they, you know, they're honest with you. Honesty is super important in the band. And just don't give up. And on top of all of this, practice. Always fucking practice. Because it's really part of it, especially when you play live. If you don't practice and you kind of like, you're lazy about things, you go live and trust me, you'll be noted. Number 10, if you could collaborate with any artist, living or dead, who would it be and why? This is a super interesting question. With the band and how things are standing at the moment with our music and with the last EP that we created, I feel like we've kind of opened the door for more technical and death metal, deathcore. So I would say I would love for us to make a song where the featured artist would be Mitch Lucker. I consider Mitch Lucker to be the best singer that has ever lived inside the genre of deathcore. Yeah, if not Mitch Lucker, if I can choose two, because, well, he's dead, and the question does ask living or dead, but someone who's alive, probably Phil Bozeman from, sorry if I'm pronouncing the name wrong, I don't know, Phil Bozeman from Whitechapel. Whitechapel is one of my favorite bands, so, yeah. Right, that's no more questions, so, pleasure. Thank you very much. And once again, this was George from Perpetual Paradox, and you're watching Concert Junkie with Rob and John.